Get higher, girl.
Hey.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Pageless Library. I am Bo Knight, and with me, as always, is Ryan Knight. And today we are doing To Kill a Mockingbird by Harper Lee and read by Sissy Speck. Is that how you say her name?
Sissy Spacek,
probably more right.
We apologize if we got that wrong.
Yeah, you can yell at us on our email, which happens to be, what is it, Ryan?
It's kotpl.pod@gmail.com. You could also tweet at us on Twitter. It's @PagelessLibrary. You could check us out over on YouTube, Knights of the Pageless Library. And, like, comment, and subscribe over there. Check us out on Facebook, Knights of the Pageless Library. And Reddit, r/KOTPO.
And first things first, I want to apologize because we took, like, a huge break. And I'm sorry for our 3 dedicated listeners who are really sad there hasn't been a new episode.
Yeah, we had some vacation and some holiday stuff going on. So, yeah, we just kind of set this aside. So, but we're back now. It's 2020 and we're back at it.
Yeah, 2020, new us.
Yeah, right.
So, yeah, To Kill a Mockingbird. We got it on Audible almost always. I mean, I don't even know where people listen to their books if they're not listening to them on Audible.
I don't really know either. The only thing I can think is I know some people will do like audio recordings on YouTube that you could just listen to.
But isn't that like stealing?
I mean, I guess. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe. But all I know is...
I guess it's no worse than like when I watch TV shows on YouTube. So.
Yeah, I mean, I do that sometimes. Although, we are knights and we are not pirates, though, so we don't condone such behavior.
Yeah, don't do such unchivalrous behavior.
Right. So, again, we got this from Audible. So, if you choose to listen to this somewhere else, your experience may vary from ours. So, we can't help you there. If you want to talk about it, go ahead and email us. We'll talk about it.
Yeah, go ahead and shoot us a real quick email.
But, so... like Bo said, this is written by Harper Lee. This book was published in 1960. So the book itself is actually pretty old.
Yeah, it's a classic.
Yeah, I think this is a classic.
I'm one of the 4 kids who didn't read it during school.
I was going to say, yeah, we did not check
this
out.
Well, we went
to
the same school.
Right. That's true. So that's probably why we both didn't experience it. And yeah, cause my wife had, she was like, yeah, we read that in school. Didn't you read that in school? I said, no, I had no idea what this book was about when I was going into it. Let's see, how much is this on Audible? Just out of curiosity.
I'm seeing it for $28.99.
Okay. Yeah. Or you could also get it for free if you start an Audible trial. Which probably actually wouldn't be a bad book to choose for your first free book, to be honest.
I mean, maybe. I don't know yet.
That's true.
So I think Harper Lee has only written like 2 books in her life. Because I think To Kill a Mockingbird was like her first book for a long time. And she didn't write anything else.
Right.
So
that's what it's looking like to me, too. And however... To Kill a Mockingbird has also been translated into like a million different languages. So pretty much anybody can read this if they want to.
Yeah.
It is a Pulitzer Prize winning book.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Sounds very prestigious.
It kind of is.
So let's talk real quickly about Sissy Spacek, though. What did you think about her?
I think she does an amazing job.
Thought she did a very good job as well.
It's honestly like insane how good of a job she does, I think, for as old as this is.
Right.
And like, I'm gonna be honest with you, like, I wish I'd listened to more of her because she's such an all-star.
Yeah, she does a really good job. She has also done...
Oh, sorry.
I was just going to say she's also done Carrie by Stephen King. She narrates
that as
well.
Which I never have listened to either, which we probably should do sometime.
Yeah, especially because I think she does such a good job in narrating. She does a really good job.
I mean, she might be my favorite, like, female narrator.
Right. I would probably hazard to say that, too. Actually.
And and this is only one book that I've heard of hers. And maybe I've heard her in the past and I just didn't realize. But she does a knockout job. And she's probably the perfect person to read this book.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say, too, is I think that she, I don't know if they could have picked a better person to kind of bring this book to life, basically.
You know what kind of feeling she gave to me was like when your teacher would read to you back in the day, but like do a really good job.
And yeah, but like when you're like a really little kid.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Okay. I could see that.
But like to do like they get like really into it and give everybody a voice right. throughout like a whole book that they read over like a month of class.
Yeah. Yeah. Because you only get to sit down and listen for like an hour, you know, a day at the most.
And she does a really good job.
Yeah, I thought so too. I thought she definitely kind of made this book for me.
So how long is this?
It is
12 hours and 17 minutes.
Yes. So, which is actually a pretty good length for a book.
Yeah, it is.
It's like a solid.
But it goes by fast.
It really does too. I mean, I have a little more to say on that when we break our spoiler wall, but yeah, it does go by pretty quick. So, and it definitely left me kind of wanting more there at the end.
I don't even really.
Which I think there.
Like, go ahead.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I think there is a follow-up to this, though, right?
But that came out not that long ago.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So it's called Go Set a Watchman, and it came out in at least the audiobook came out in 2015.
Yeah, it's so, not that new.
Right. You mean it's not that old?
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Okay. Yeah, because as far as, yeah, spacing between books goes, I'm not sure if
and
there's
it's way many, shorter.
Many books that are spaced out that far apart.
I don't think it was nearly as good.
Yeah, I wouldn't know. But, so what would you say, like, the genre of this book
is? That's what I was trying to figure out. Like, it's kind of like a coming-to-age story a little bit.
Sort of.
I don't know, like, and there's a little bit of law drama in there, and,
yeah.
Like, a little bit of, like, a slice of life thing.
That's a very good way to describe it, because I was having a hard time coming up with a genre, too, because it's not really, like, I mean, it's basically just kind of following these people for a snippet of their life, is kind of what it does.
Right. It's like a transformative event, though, right? Events.
Yeah, I mean that's fair to say.
I don't know. Is a slice of life is like the only way I can really think of to put it.
Yeah, no, I think that's a pretty good way to put it. I would say that sums it up pretty well.
It's about Scout, this young girl. Like it's set in the South. Like what time? It's like during the Great Depression, right?
Yeah, it's pretty. Yeah, I think so.
And it's basically just her kind of growing up. That's I don't really I know like, there's nobody else who's never heard of this book, but like I really don't want to like I feel like give away anything.
Yeah, no, and I wouldn't spoil anything yet. So, do you think this one was easy to listen to though? Was it easy to follow along?
I mean, it is easy to follow along, but I think you can kind of get lost in the minutiae of it if you aren't listening good enough. Like, this isn't something I would have on, like when other people are trying to talk to me or something else like that. Like, you kind of need to be a little bit focused on the words.
I think you're right, and I think that's especially true in the beginning.
Yeah.
And if I'm being honest, this one almost lost me in the beginning to the point where I was like, this book is dumb.
Really?
Yeah. So I actually had to restart it twice because in the beginning, you're thrown kind of so many characters and so many names. Yeah. all like rapid fire, and I don't like that. So that kind of caught me off guard. And at first, I didn't like that at all. But
the beginning is a little rough.
Yeah, but I think once you get in, like past that, I don't know, 1 hour mark, it's pretty cut and dry, but straightforward from there. The story, they don't bounce around a lot. The story is very chronological and follows one kind of path, so it makes it a lot easier from there.
Yeah, I agree.
So what would you say for your recommendation on this one?
Like, if you haven't ever read this or seen the movie, you gotta listen to the audiobook. And I think the audiobook is amazing. Like, the quality is just, it's good. There's a reason it's a classic. There's a reason.
Yeah, I'm sure it won't come to the surprise of, because most people have probably read this or, like you said, checked it out in school or something. So, I mean, but I also would recommend this, especially like the audiobook. So like, I know when I was in school and we were required to read something, I would usually try instead to find it on audiobook and listen to it.
It's the move, honestly.
Well, this one though, like if you're a kid in school and they want you to read this, you would not be doing yourself a disservice by getting the audiobook and just listening to it. I mean, you know, you'll get all the same information, obviously, as if you read it, but you could also be doing other things technically at the same time. So,
you know, it's a strange realization I just had. I used to hate book reports so much, and now we basically do them.
We basically do them for fun. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's like super fun is the thing.
It actually is. Yeah. I mean, it is very fun.
I don't know, Ryan. How do you feel about this?
I mean, I'm enjoying it. The hardest part for us is scheduling, because we're in different time zones and we both work and stuff. So the hardest part for us to do this is to sit down and actually just record. And I always get disappointed when one of us can't do it. Especially if we schedule it, we're like, hey man, 6 o'clock tonight, we're going to do this. And then all of a sudden it's like, I'm not going to be able to make it. I get really disappointed that we can't just sit down and do it. So no, definitely fun. I mean, and this is a weird spot to put this, but I just want to thank anybody who listens to our stuff, because it's awesome to see that anybody listens to any of it.
Yeah,
so
it is really cool. I don't know how else to put it.
But again, don't be shy. You guys can email us. You guys can talk to us.
We would literally lose our minds. Like, I don't think you understand. like we would get so excited.
Yeah, we've had a couple YouTube comments, which I really like. Usually I'm the one checking them and responding to them. So, but I really like it. It's awesome to see any kind of engagement on the stuff that we're doing. So,
okay, segue, Kill a Mockingbird. So let's go past the spoiler wall and talk about it a little bit more.
Okay. So for anybody who doesn't know, anybody who's new here, we're gonna go ahead and sum up the story. So if you haven't listened to it, you want to listen to it, please go do that, and then come back and hear what we have to say.
So, yeah, okay. So we talked about Scout a little bit. I don't even really know where to start, if I'm honest.
I mean, you can kind of start at the beginning, but that's what I mean. The beginning is kind of muddied to me.
I don't really want to go piece by piece, though.
No, I wouldn't do that. So Scout is what? She's like 10?
She's really young girl. She's like a tomboy, and what's her brother's name? Jim. And she lives with her dad, Atticus, who is the town's public defender. And they live in this town in the south that is super duper like racist, because it's kind of that time.
Well, it's part of the time, because it's in the early 1900s, like what I think it says, like the 30s.
Right.
So I mean, that's literally just how it was then.
Right. And so they have a neighbor, right? He lives like across the street that they're really fascinated with. His name's Boo Radley. Is it Boo? Is that his actual name?
I can't remember what they end up saying at the end. Now I can't think of it. It's been a while since I listened to it, unfortunately.
Me too, which is a shame.
I think that's right. Boo Radley, yeah. I think that's not his real name though, because they
that's
tell
what I,
them,
yeah.
Yeah, they tell them to stop calling him that because that's not his real name.
So he like lives across the street. They're really fascinated with him because he never comes outside and they've never seen him.
Yeah. So there's all these like, he's basically like he's like the Loch Ness Monster to them.
Kind of. And then like from there, right, like I really like the Boo, like that Boo's like, they never like come out and say it, but he's like leaving gifts for them in that one tree.
Well, so what happens is because the kids are so interested in Boo Radley, but they're scared of him because they hear all these stories that he's like. So it's Scout and her brother and their cousin, right, for the most part. And so they're always like, they're trying to like sneak up to the house and see if they can see him and all this stuff. His name is Arthur, by the way. Arthur Boo Radley. And Scout is 6, by the way.
Dang, she's way young.
Yeah. Anyways, so they're always trying to keep, you know, basically sneak a peek at Boo Radley. But they're terrified that he'll catch them and he'll, like, kill them. So they're always going by the house because the house is really close to theirs. And, yeah, all of a sudden they start noticing, like, in this tree on their walk to school, in this little knot in the tree, there's, like, stuff that'll be left in there, like coins and, like, little trinkets and stuff like that. And, yeah, it was Boo Radley because he likes – the way I understand it is he likes that they're interacting with him at all.
Yeah.
Because he is. He's like a shut-in. Like, he never comes out of the house.
Yeah, and, like, more antics with him happen all the time. Like, Jim gets his pants caught on the fence when they're running away from the house one time, and then he comes back to get them the next day, and they're already stitched up and just laying on the fence.
Yeah, they're, like, folded over the fence, but they're
but, like, lovingly laid on the fence.
Right, but they're stitched up like it looks like a really, like, poorly stitched up job. Yeah. And then, so the story kind of shifts a little bit away from the kids and their shenanigans, and it kind of focuses more on Atticus for a little while during this trial, right?
The kids' perspective, though, which is really interesting.
Right, because the kids sneak in to the trial.
But that's not even what I'm talking about. I'm talking about, like, all the stress that kind of leads up to the trial. You know, like, how they're getting called bad things.
And, oh, sure, sure.
And Atticus is getting called bad things to them. But they, like, don't actually really understand what Atticus is doing.
Right. And they don't even understand why other people are mad at Atticus. So the whole point of the case is because Atticus, who is white, is the defendant for a black man during this supposed rape case.
Right. So, and Atticus has been the public defender for this town for, like, many, many years, and he runs, like, unopposed, because I get the feeling, like, that he has to deal with this shit a lot.
Right. Well, this kind of struck me, though, as the first time, like, it was a really, really big deal. Like, that's why everybody was basically mad at Atticus.
Well, I thought it was a big deal that they would even give him a trial, I think.
Oh, yeah. I think you're right. Yeah. But they ended up giving him a trial because supposedly the only ones who witnessed this rape is the woman who got raped and her father. But the people in question are like hillbilly freaking, you know, white trash people that none of the town really likes anyways.
Right. And
that's
I think
pretty much why it went to trial.
And we can pretty much shift, I think, to the trial itself. And I think this is where the book is at its best.
Yeah. Oh, and by the way, I know it's 2020, but if you are squeamish about the N-word, you can't listen to this book.
Yeah, you can't. And you're not allowed to be mad about it either.
No, you're not.
It's a period piece.
Exactly. It's when it was being told, you know, that's how people talked. And I'm not going to lie, there was even parts where I got uncomfortable, but then I was like, well, that's how it was. It's good for people, especially like younger people of our generation, to realize that stuff hasn't always been quite so easy peasy, cushy, safe space stuff. It's not how it's been. You know, there have been really hard times even in this country. Just because it hasn't always been hard for white people doesn't mean there hasn't been really hard times in this country.
Right. So the trial is supposedly this guy named Tom Robinson raped this girl like on his way home from work one day. Because he walks past there every day. to go to the cotton fields where he works.
And they, so they bring up all this evidence, but basically the evidence is just this girl's story. And
right,
so,
and Tom Robinson tells a completely different story.
Right.
Well, so, and she has, like, bruises on her, she had bruises on, like, her right side, right?
It was the right side of her face, yeah.
Right. And Tom Robinson was crippled on his left side. Was that right?
It would be her right side. Yeah, his left arm is, like, all crippled and short, and, like, he can't really... Like, he's a big strapping dude, so they were like, well, obviously he could take advantage of this, you know, little white girl. But, yeah, his, like, left arm... Because the whole point of the story was that he hit her, and she fell down, and then he raped her. But he, like, clearly couldn't have hit her with his left arm, because it, like, doesn't work. So
right.
That was kind of like Atticus's... freaking ace up his sleeve.
Well, I mean, he brought up lots of stuff that doesn't make sense.
Yeah, actually, so, I mean, without even explaining the whole trial, the trial was actually my favorite part of the whole book.
That's what I said.
Yeah, it was definitely my favorite part, because just listening to it and the way it's told was like masterfully done.
Yeah.
And so at the end, though, of the trial, Atticus says his piece, and then the prosecutioner says his piece, and the prosecutioner is basically like, essentially, you get the thing that's like, look, she's white, he's black, how much more to this story do you need?
Yeah.
Even though everything Atticus brought up was like, look, these people are lying. Clearly, they're lying. I mean, it was a very clear, and you as the listener, you don't know what the real story is. You're listening to this trial. There was no, like...
Right. We didn't. We don't know anything about this, really, until the kids actually go to court.
Mm-hmm.
Which is actually really towards the end of the book.
Yeah.
But you hear a lot kind of like, murmurings and whisperings about it throughout the town.
Right. And then, at the end, it's still up to the jury to decide what happens with Tom Robinson. And... they still find him guilty, and I'm not going to lie, I started crying.
It is like the biggest gut punch of all time.
I really did, because I was like, there's no way they're going to find him guilty. I was like, Atticus did such a good job of proving that these people are just trash pieces of shit, and they just are blaming him because they're trash. And yeah, the jury still finds Tom Robinson guilty. And yeah. That was one of the hardest things I've ever listened to in any book ever.
Well, and in I had to, like, I feel like we have to mention too that Atticus also kind of humiliates the father of this girl that got raped, because he kind of makes him he shows the court that he's a fucking idiot and a lying piece of shit.
He's an idiot. He's a drunk.
Yeah.
He clearly hits his kids, which he has a lot of kids. And they're just like white trash people. So, yeah, you're absolutely right. During the trial, he humiliates this girl's father. And he basically, pretty much during the trial, he's like, look, we all know you hit her. Why are you trying to blame this man for hitting her? So.
But the guy, like, vows to fucking get back at Atticus.
Right. What's that guy's name?
I fucking can't remember.
Ewell?
Yeah.
Ewells? Does that sound right? Ewells?
I think it's their last name.
Ewells? Must be Ewells. Yeah, Ewells is their last name. But yeah, this dude basically says, tells Atticus to watch his back after that. Even though they got off, you know, they got what they wanted. Tom Robinson was accused, guilty. So.
And then from there, like, the book is, like, almost over. But Scout goes to this play in this, like, potato costume, and she totally screws up and doesn't go to the queue on time when she's supposed to. No, she's a pork, right? She's a ham.
She's like a ham, yeah, ham.
So she's, like, dressed up, and she can't really see very well, and she can't move her arms.
Right.
And so they're walking home, her and Jim, and something, like, is following them, and they get scared, so they run, and she trips, and then, like, she hears a bunch of things happen. And then, like, from there, you kind of find out that, like, the Yule guy was after them, and he's dead now. Like, something happened, and he's dead.
Yeah, so that part was super intense.
It was super intense.
Because Scout and Jim basically get attacked by a grown man with a knife. So it's really intense.
But I love that it's like you get it from Scout's perspective, and she doesn't really see a whole lot because she can't.
Really, right, she can't really see anything. She just knows somebody falls on her, and then something pokes her, and something rips her costume, and she can hear her brother and somebody scuffling. And then all of a sudden it goes like quiet.
Yeah, which I like the way that that's told.
Yeah, I liked it too. I thought it was it was definitely, like I said, it was like tense. Like you were like, oh my God, what is going to happen?
Well, and then so from there, the sheriff comes to Atticus's house and Atticus thinks that Jim killed him. Atticus is like admirate that he's like, fuck, Jim killed him and we have to go through the proper authorities to deal with this because like I'm such an honorable man. I know it's still my son and he didn't mean to do it, but we still have to do this.
Right. Well, and the sheriff is there, and the sheriff is like, look, man, he fell on this knife.
Yeah.
That's what killed him. He fell on this knife. And Atticus is like, no, we have to take my son to trial. Yeah. Like, it's kind of heartbreaking because Atticus is so
heartbreaking. but he didn't actually fall on his knife either, though.
Right. So the sheriff, so this whole time, too, when Jim wakes up in this room because he got knocked out, and he wakes up. There's also when Scout is visiting him up there, there's this man in the corner that she doesn't recognize. This big man.
Right, because somebody had carried Jim home.
Right. Yeah, that's right. But Scout doesn't recognize this guy. And he just kind of standing in the corner, quiet. And she ends up realizing, though, that it's Boo Radley.
Right.
And basically, Boo Radley heard this scuffle going on and seen this dude trying to kill these kids, and he ran out there and he freaking
saved them
and stabbed this dude, this piece of shit dude.
Yeah, he killed the piece of shit who deserved it.
Right. But the sheriff of the town is like, no, man, this guy fell on his knife.
Right.
And he's like, and I'm the sheriff of the town, and that's the story that happened.
Yeah. But the sheriff isn't, like, corrupt. Like, he's not a piece of shit like the rest of them.
No, he's not. But he also knows, you know, he's pretty sure that Boo killed this guy. However.
Right, and it's like, I was just saying, like, he's not part of, like, the racism that's going on.
Oh, no. He's actually, the way they describe him, he's actually, like, a very level-headed, fair guy, it sounds like.
Right.
But yeah, so they kind of protect a few of them in more ways than one because obviously Boo should have been accused of that. But the sheriff's just like, this man attacked your kids and during the scuffle, he fell on his own knife and he killed himself.
Yeah.
Said, and that's the story I'm sticking with.
And isn't that pretty much the end?
Yeah, Scout basically walks Boo Radley home, who she basically describes as like a really big child because he's pretty simple. So it kind of sums up everything that was happening to them, like all the little trinkets that were left behind and the way he was trying to interact with them, even though he never came out of the house. So it's like super touching, though.
It is. It's a quality story.
It really is. Like it's very touching. And like I said, coming into this, I had zero expectations. I had never seen the movie, never heard what this book was about. I'd seen the movie before. Oh, see, I hadn't seen that at all. I had no idea what I was in for. None. And it was an awesome surprise.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah, it's really good. I mean, obviously, there's a reason it's a classic. We don't have to tell people that. But, I mean, you know, if you've never read it or heard it or watched the movie, I mean, and I've never watched the movie, so maybe we'll have to do that at some point, too.
You could. It's black and white, dude.
Yeah, that's what I heard. But, yeah, you could definitely do yourself a favor and listen to this one, for sure.
Okay, so I think we should wrap this one up. We'll do the thank yous again. Like, thank you, everybody, for listening. Like,
yes.
Really, I really appreciate every single person who bothers to click on this. It really means a lot to us.
Yeah, it really does too. I mean, and I know everybody says that who puts out any kind of entertainment stuff. But seriously, we really appreciate it. So, what are we gonna do next time, Bob?
I think next time we're gonna take a little departure, and I want to do something a little different. But I haven't come up with a good name yet.
Don't even throw any out there yet. We'll talk about it a little bit. If anybody has any suggestions for, let's see, what would it be? Something to do with a downfall, basically.
I don't know. What we're gonna do is look at a series that we have both seen from start to finish to where it is now.
Right.
And we're gonna talk about like kind of the journey it's taken.
Correct.
I don't know how else to put it.
That's kind of all you have to say. So, yeah, and we've talked about one of the books in the series so far, but we're not going to go into every single book in the series because it's a very long series and the books themselves are very long. So what we've done, though, is Bo is re-listening to a book out of the series and I'm re-listening to a book out of the series, and then we're going to talk about the series as a whole, essentially. So...
Right. Yeah, kind of. I want to talk about too the freaking other side things.
Yeah,
a
absolutely.
Little bit.
Yeah. Even if they're not exactly canon to the original story. Yeah,
I think they're all canon.
Yeah, actually you're probably right. But yeah, we're going to talk about some little spin-off stuff that happened with this series too. But that's what we're going to do next time. So
it's going to be something a little different, I think. And we're just going to try it out and see if we like it.
Yeah.
And it's probably going to be a long one, so buckle up.
Yeah, definitely buckle up, I feel like, because we're both going to have probably way too much to say about it. So
yeah.
But yeah, again, thank you everybody for listening. And I think we will catch you guys in the next one.
Yeah, so don't kill any birds while you're out there.